Se dia alguém perguntar por mim, diz que vivi para te amar.
Terms to face what is, of course, an unprecedented crisis. I'm going to do this, if you agree, by sharing a little PowerPoint presentation just to help you digest what I have to tell a little bit more easily. And I would maybe ask Annabelle to allow me to share my screen so that I can show you these slides. And then after about 25 minutes, I'm very happy to engage in any discussion that you might wish to have. So I'm doing that now. And I would just like to verify that you can actually see my screen. Is that working? I see some sure. Nodding. Excellent. So let me then start by giving you the menu for the talk. I would like to talk about the big picture, as I've said, and then on that basis, zoom in on the budgetary and economic policy response through the EU budget and this instrument, which is called Next Generation EU, or the recovery instrument, at the heart of which sits the recovery and resilience facility. I think that really is a very important departure in policy terms. I would then afterwards look at the next steps, everything that is still to come from today, because we're really in the middle of rolling out this process, and then I'd be very happy to take your questions. But let me start with a statement of our president, which I think is very, very aptly chosen. And what she says here, that the battle against the virus is a marathon and not a sprint, requiring foresight, endurance, and stamina, is really extremely valid. We started last year in early March designing the strategy. When we were engaged in the negotiations of the multi-annual financial framework, so the seven-year budget for the EU. And I was actually in her office when the first reports were coming in, and we were contemplating after the February European Council what could be done. And at that juncture, it's hard to imagine, the crisis wasn't a pandemic yet. It was a horrible event taking place in China. But then as we were meeting, and we had very intensive meetings basically every day at that time, it appeared that Italy was being affected, the first cases in Belgium were being observed, and gradually it was dawning on us that actually this was a situation that was extremely serious, and that would overtake the entire agenda, the entire policy agenda, which the president of the Commission had mapped out upon her arrival just a few months earlier. So she then decided that given the real risks to Europe, we needed to do this together. And for that, we worked up, as the crisis unfolded, more or less in real time, building the car while we were driving it, so to speak, what I would call a relatively comprehensive strategy. And I'm going to talk you through this by going clockwise from the top to the bottom. So at the heart of the strategy is actually a European vaccine strategy. And this flows from the fact that without managing the pandemic and the health impact, nothing can actually be achieved. The economics are really driven by the health situation. And at the very start, when the crisis hit and every member state was in there for themselves, closing borders, hoarding materials that were essential for the medical systems, not sharing PPEs, essentially ripping up the internal market. All of this was happening, you will recall, in March. We realized that unless we coordinated this, not only would we have a huge health crisis in Europe, but also the economic fabric and the social fabric of the Union risked unraveling. And that is why the strategy from the very beginning was focused on trying to make Europe work for solving the crisis, but also making sure that Europe wouldn't be the victim of the crisis, so to speak. And vaccines very early on, I would say in the last week of March, when we had initial discussions with immunologists and experts in this field, emerged as a promising thing. No one really knew whether this could be developed. No one really knew what it would cost. No one really knew how long it would take to get these things. But it was clear that unless vaccines were developed and found, the crisis could not be abated. So we actually activated the last week of March a budgetary tool called the Emergency Support Instrument, which is really an option of last resort to bring forward measures to effectively fight emergency situations. And we put all of the remaining money in the budget, 2.7 billion euros in it, and we proposed to the council, we said, listen, we need this, we will need it quickly, you need it, and we better decide. I tell you, this was decided in 7 working days. It's the fastest ever decision-making procedure in the history of the union. And it's a lot of money that was made available in that decision. So in addition to vaccines, which were clearly a driving motivation, this also looked at other emergency resources, such as protective suits, but also bringing home stranded travelers. And alongside that, the Commission started bringing into play measures to coordinate travel, to coordinate the external borders, to open up the internal borders for freight transport, and to try to put some order into what was a very messy situation. So that's the second building block on the right. And then thirdly, very early on, we realized that this is the type of situation where no one is safe until everyone is safe. Nowadays, this is a commonplace. But when we started making these noises in April, May, and we launched, together with a number of international parties, a big fundraising to start financing an international vaccines initiative called COVAX Gavi, under the auspices of the WHO, this was really very new. And the president opted for a rather innovative way of fundraising, using many celebrities in addition to leading politicians to raise funds. This is the Team Europe approach to help partners, and not just those in our neighborhood, but also more globally, based on, if you will, enlightened self-interest, because clearly with migration and with travel, unless other countries also vaccinate the population, we will never really be able to return to a degree of normality.
May I just ask to put the view options? There is a part of your slide which we cannot see. If you put on view options and you choose hide video panel, because we see there is a...
Right.
Sorry. But there were some people in the chat.
Let me see how I do that.
So normally it's view options. Right, the video panel. It's just a small part of your slide at the right hand side, which is not.
Is it better like this?
Not yet. Yes.
Yeah. Okay, great. So apologies. So I was saying that in addition to this international outreach, we also lumped in the testing and quarantine recommendations, all part of this coordinated health response. And only then, in parallel to working on the health situation, we realized that the impact on the economy was huge. And the impact on the economy was not only huge, this is probably the biggest economic crisis synchronized globally since the Second World War, but actually the impact in Europe was also divergent. So some countries were hit earlier, and some countries with big service industries, such as tourism, for example, were hit harder. Think Italy, think Spain, countries very reliant on tourism. So the risk here was not only that there would be a generalized depression in the EU, but also that the divergences in the internal market would create a ripple effect that could unravel the economic fabric of the union. And that is why we believed and still believe that a coordinated response was really necessary if ever we all stand to gain from this response. And that's where the economic strategy came from. So now, let me then give you some statistics to give you a sense of how much work was actually done. We changed in the economic sphere the essential two rule books, namely the state aid framework, allowing member states to support their economies. And here in Belgium, for example, there is massive support for the service economies. Otherwise, large part of the economies would have simply disappeared. So the state aid framework was overhauled, and the Commission, until the end of last month, took 689 state aid decisions. But secondly, we also activated the emergency clause in the Stability and Growth Pact, which is the macroeconomic budgetary policy framework for member states, allowing them to mobilize resources and to go into the red. And what is interesting is that very early on, people realized that significant economic support was needed, that the budgetary situation should not be the constraint. In fact, budgetary conservatism would have pushed the economy really into a depression, and ultimately would have led to even bigger budgetary problems further down the road. So these two responses were very significant indeed. Now, on the health and emergency response, let me underline that in this visual, you can see how important the different strands were. We did not have any competences to coordinate health policies formally under the treaty, so no legal competences, but nevertheless, member states expected us to do this to protect the internal market, and hence the European Health Union as a motivating idea and concept was born and is very much alive today. You will have heard Chancellor Merkel earlier this week speaking about actually now formalizing some of these competences. But for today, I want to focus a bit more on the economics. And before I do that, I promised to say a word about vaccines, especially because earlier this year, there was this sentiment that our vaccine strategy was a big failure. And this showed that Europe should have never got involved in the first place. I want to correct that mistaken image by underlining that it is very, very clear that Europe, in fact, by ordering 2.6 billion doses of vaccines at a time when none of these vaccines even existed, let alone had been tested or approved for that matter, actually coordinated and bought on behalf of all 27 member states through advance purchase agreements, which really reserved the right to obtain vaccines in return for investments in the production capacity of the companies. And by taking a diversified approach, given that we didn't know which vaccines would be successful, we hedged our bets. And this, I think, very clearly, beyond any doubt, has led to a situation where all 27 member states are guaranteed a supply of vaccines. And the counterfactual of not coordinating it at the European level can be found in other parts of the world where smaller countries, poorer countries are struggling to get access to vaccines, or where they get access, they pay huge sums of money they can poorly afford. So a clear example of European value added by pooling our resources, we were and still are the largest purchaser of vaccines in the world. We managed with these big pharmaceutical companies to obtain good terms and conditions and therefore secured these vaccines. Now, you will say, what is he talking about? We all know this is a failed strategy. The vaccines are late. Look at the US, much faster, the UK, much faster. But what I want to say is that if you look at this graph, you see one manufacturer called AstraZeneca that actually promised us 130 million vaccines by March of this year. They delivered less than 30 million by March of this year. And this alone explains the difference in vaccination rates between the US and the EU. This alone, nothing else explains the difference. So we had amongst all of these contracts, one manufacturer who was basically not living up to the contractual conditions, Commission is taking this manufacturer to court, as you know, but otherwise the other manufacturers are actually delivering, and our timelines, as you can see now, will see record delivery of vaccines in the second quarter of this year, putting us very comfortably in reach of reaching the objective that was set under the vaccine strategy of inoculating, so vaccinating 70% of European adults by the summer. We're well on track, actually. We're a little bit ahead of schedule in terms of the doses we will be obtaining. And therefore, I think that when we look back in the summer at this episode, we will remember the anxieties of February and March, where things were moving very slowly. But first and foremost, by that stage, we will be rejoicing in having opened economies, not just in the few big member states that would have gotten the vaccines anyway, but in all 27. So that's what I want to say about the vaccines, just to correct a misperception. And for you, I would like to reveal as a little primer that we're also purchasing up to 1.8 billion vaccines for 2022 and 2023, all from BioNTech Pfizer at this juncture, which will be delivered in such a way that they are much more secure in their delivery schedules, even if BioNTech Pfizer is delivering on time. But they will also, and this is crucial, deal with variants of the virus, and therefore provide an extremely high degree of protection. This is, again, an example of clear European value added. So to give you a few numbers, by the 23rd of April, we had delivered 150 million vaccines. And of these, 123 million had been actually administered. So the strategy is well on track. Now, let me come to the economics, the main dish for tonight. I've talked already a little bit about the economic response, state aid rules, the general escape clause in the Stability and Growth Pact activated on the left-hand side and the right-hand side of this picture. But we did more. We also brought a funding system for short-time work schemes, so people who were, in essence, laid off, were not laid off, but kept on shorter working hours. This is called SHORE, where we made 100 billion euros of soft loans available, and my department is actually raising that money in the market. These funds are on lent, so they're made available to the member states, and given that the European Union benefits from a AAA rating, we have managed to attract very affordable conditions. In fact, the interest rate advantage in total is expected to be about 10 billion euros over the lifetime of this program. So that's already running. We're at 75 billion euros and counting. We also, at the bottom right-hand side of this graph, made our structural and cohesion funds available by flexibilizing the rules, by allowing member states to reprogram and direct the envelopes they had to investments in the healthcare system and in supporting SMEs and short-time working schemes. That has led to about 130 billion euros of money being redirected and 18 billion euros of investments in healthcare and some 7 billion euros of additional liquidity being provided. Now, obviously, we're not alone in this, and everyone knows that the ECB, the central bank of the euro area, is providing significant support to facilitate monetary transmission, thereby avoiding that the financial markets seize up. And they have brought in a pandemic emergency program, essentially a qualitative easing program aimed at purchasing bonds to ensure that the monetary transmission system functions properly. And that is the central theme of my talk, also worked up the recovery plan for Europe, including 750 billion euros of support on top of the normal long-term budget for 7 years. The long-term budget stands at about 1 trillion 74 euros, and the the recovery plan for Europe at about 750 billion euros. That will be spent in a very front-loaded way, this next generation EU, in the coming 2.5 years. Now, if you want to look at it a little bit differently, it's also worth looking at the other measures that member states and the EIB group have taken. So member states have made liquidity measures available to the tune of 2.5 trillion euros, essentially providing soft loans to companies. The ESM, the European Stability Mechanism, has provided credit lines, which have not been tapped yet, but they're there, of 240 billion euros. The EIB group, our European Investment Bank, has made additional funding available for businesses to the tune of 200 billion euros. That is being drawn. And national measures under the flexibility of the EU budgetary rules amount, roughly speaking, to 524 billion euros. So if you add this up, and this is a very rough calculation, and good economists will tell me I can't add up grants and loans, but nevertheless, to give you a sense of the support, it stands at about 3.7 trillion euros across all actors who contribute to this. And I think even if you deduct some of the liquidity measures, that doesn't compare unfavorably with responses elsewhere in the world. So the economic policy response has been tremendous. Now, the recovery plan for Europe, as I've said, is really revolutionary. And the reason for this is manifold. The first is that for the first time ever, the European Commission will be borrowing this money on the capital markets and running it through the EU budget to support the economy, including through a revolutionary program called the Recovery and Resilience Facility. This is a temporary one-off measure needed to fight the crisis, but it actually has huge implications because obviously we will be writing EU bonds to the tune of 750 billion euros, which will be traded on international capital markets. And that alone has very important implications. Secondly, by giving this big fiscal impulse at the European level, we can deal with the divergences, so the differences across EU economies, and the distribution key in the budget for this instrument actually takes full account of how hard economies are hit and how poor they are to begin with. So that allows us to keep the European economy together and avoid spillover effects that will damage everyone. So that is another very important feature of the response. So let me drill a little bit deeper. This has been hailed as a once-in-a-generation opportunity to rebuild a better Europe. And I can tell you, having attended the European Council in July of last year, which went on for 4 days and nights, with preciously little sleep, collapsed on couches and chairs, that there was a sentiment really in the room that we had set out a really rather dramatically new joint measure to deal with this unprecedented crisis. It comes through Next Generation EU, as I've said. Let me give you a bit more detail here. 750 billion euros in so-called 2018 prices, of which 390 billion euros will be disbursed as grants, subsidies, if you will, under the EU programs. And 360 billion euros will be made available to member states as loans. And the bulk of this, about 90%, will run through this recovery and resilience facility, which is therefore by far the biggest program in the budget. And it has indeed many really significant features. In current prices, it is worth about 724 billion euros. Out of the 807 billion euros that Next Generation EU in current prices will provide. And it effectively is a system where member states, in return for reforms of their economy and investments in their economy that are forward-looking, future-oriented, supports their economies based on the distribution key I have already alluded to. And this is really very new. So we've, for a long time in Europe, had an economic policy coordination mechanism under the so-called European semester, where we have been giving recommendations to member states about the course of their economic policies. But the weakness of the system, to be honest, is that it neither offers rewards, if you will, carrots for complying with these recommendations, nor does it contain sticks or sanctions for failure to comply with these recommendations. This time it's different. Member states have to submit these plans with very clearly defined targets and milestones. And under the Recovery and Resilience Facility, they are paid in installments in return for delivering on these reforms and investments. So this is very different from any other budget program we have. It's very different from cohesion policy, where essentially we are compensating for costs that member states have incurred under programs. Here, we're not interested in the costs per se, even if, of course, we have looked at the reasonability of the underlying investments in economic terms, but we pay when there is delivery. So there is the focus on results is hardwired into the program. And this is very different. And if you will, it gives real teeth, it gives real fuel to the European semester and the country specific recommendations. It also is built on six, if you will, themes which member states have to reflect in their national plans, namely the need to essentially redirect their economies towards a growth path that is sustainable in environmental and especially in climate terms, but also that is modernized when it comes to the digital future that we will all need to embrace. So the themes here are power up, which is all about technologies and renewables, renovate, which is essential to bring down emissions. 25% of global greenhouse gas emissions emanate from buildings. It looks at sustainable transport and charging systems under the recharge and refuel section, where we will be tackling another 25% of emissions. It, under the Connect program, funds the rollout of rapid broadband services, still missing in many economies. In Italy, there is very poor internet connections and broadband services outside of the cities. It looks to modernize and digitalize public administrations. It also scales up data cloud and sustainable processes. And finally, crucially, it helps reskill and upskill the workforce by training to support digital needs. So this is a program that is directed at fighting the crisis, but at the same time, if you will, innovating and upgrading the economic structure of the economies, in many cases dealing with long-standing weaknesses in these economies to put them back on a growth path. And this is expressed by two targets which all member states' plans individually have to meet. 37% of the expenditure will have to go towards climate investments and reforms, and 20% will need to be allocated to investments for the digital transition. And the plans can only be signed off by the Commission, which will make the assessment, if they meet these targets. But as I said before, they also need to address the key country-specific recommendations that deal with things like pension reforms, labor market reforms, the need to improve the functioning of public administrations, the need to improve the business environment, do away with red tape, and what have you. Now, how will this actually work in practice? Member states are supposed to submit their national plans with clear milestones and targets, and they can do so by the end of this month, so literally in a few days' time, by Friday. They can also be a little bit later, and some will come later, but this is the general rule. The Commission will then assess these plans based on what I've told you, so the targets, the milestones, the country-specific recommendations, and we have about 2 months to do so. The Council, so the member states, the ministers of economic affairs, will then need to approve the national plans based on this commission proposal. And then once this is done, the commission will make the pre-financing available to the tune of 13% of the value of the plans within 2 months. And we will fund this, as I've said, by issuing bonds on the market. And that's, in fact, my responsibility in the commission at this juncture. Afterwards, member states will need to implement these plans, and they will need to hit and reach, demonstrate that they reach the agreed milestones and targets in different steps between now and 2026. And up to twice a year, they can then request further financial disbursements in return for demonstrating that they've actually reached these milestones and targets. And of course, the Commission will then be checking this through a preliminary assessment of the request. There's a comitology procedure, for those of you who know what that is, namely an involvement of member states experts. And once this is approved, then the Commission will be financing these plans. So there's strict conditionality, so to speak, but equally a very clear roadmap. Now, I've already mentioned the link with the European semester, the country-specific recommendations. You see the huge activities, especially in countries in the south of Europe and the east of Europe, where the amounts concerned are very big, where, for example, President Draghi in Italy has called this a once-in-a-generation chance for Italy. In fact, he's recently, just yesterday, labeled this as a last chance for Italy. So it's a six-year economic program, really, that is being laid out, 200 billion euros for Italy. So national ownership of the investment and reform priorities is key. No one can impose such a huge economic program from the outside. It has to be owned. And that's why member states are working rather hard to work up these plans. And as I've said, payments only in return for achievements. And finally, and this is really important, and in the end, one of the key reasons this was run through the EU budget, of course, the EU budget has strict rules on the fight against fraud, corruption, and financial irregularities. So the basic budgetary rules will help make sure that every euro will go to where the needs are, and if there are problems, that amounts can be recovered. Now, the way forward. We are today, 27th of April. I've mapped out that the plan should all be coming in literally in the next few days. But before the money can actually start flowing, of course, there's still two conditions that need to be fulfilled. One is a legal requirement, which effectively implies that all member states, so all 27 member states, need to ratify, that is, under national procedures, agree a law which has been passed last December, which is called the Own Resources Decision, which is the legal basis for our borrowing decisions. We're presently at 19 member states having ratified. 8 still need to go. I can reassure you that Belgium is in, the Netherlands is not yet in, I hate to say. And there are a few others who still need to come on board, but that needs to be done before we can start our borrowing activities. And secondly, for obvious reasons, the national plans need to be adopted. However, switching a bit to the financing side, I want to reassure everyone that we are racing to get up our activities, to get ready our activities, so that we can start borrowing as of the 1st of June. So we will be ready with this machine. It's called the Next Generation EU Funding Strategy, and it comes with essentially a whole apparatus to operate in the financial market, markets like the biggest borrowers internationally. Here you have a little slide where you can see which member states have ratified, which are still to go. So you see in the north, Finland, Poland, Hungary, Romania, Austria, Ireland. So we're not there yet, but we are very hopeful that we will get there by the end of next month. As far as the plans are concerned, the first official submission took place on the 22nd of April last week by Portugal, which is the present presidency of the Council of the European Union. We have seen presentations only yesterday of the French and German plans. They have not yet been submitted. Spain is very advanced. A number of member states are already moving towards the final stages, and discussions with member states are intensifying, because I haven't mentioned this yet. In fact, member states have been discussing with our colleagues in the Commission for the past months as they worked on the plan. On the borrowing side, what this means, as I said, is that the Commission will need to raise about 800 billion euros between now and the end of 2026 on the financial markets, which on average means about 150 billion euro per year, front-loaded in the first 3 years, so some 200 billion euro per year. And as I've explained, 90% of the proceeds will go to the Recovery and Resilience Facility, but there are also a number of other budget programs, some very targeted, that will benefit from these top-ups raised on the markets. Let me mention the Just Transition Fund, which seeks to facilitate the transition towards a more carbon neutral economy by effectively putting in place economic conditions to do so. And of course, Horizon Europe, our flagship research program, you are no doubt all familiar with. Now, given that we'll be borrowing at this scale, and that we will be routing the financing through the budget, we have to operate like a very large sovereign. And that means that we will be borrowing using a wide variety of techniques, including auctions, including syndications, but also issuing bills, so short-dated bonds. And that this funding will also need to be held in a liquidity reserve so that we can disburse these payments. And we'll be in the market for a long time, because the repayment of these loans and grants will run until 2058. So this will be a gradual reduction of our outstanding stock of debt, but it's a long period in time where a large volume of AAA rated bonds will be out in the markets. So how are we going to do this? We will be issuing 6 monthly funding plans explaining how we plan to raise the money on a 6 monthly basis. We'll be creating a European primary dealer network, essentially top European banks that will help us do this. Banks can apply provided they meet certain conditions. I've already mentioned the different instruments we will be using, but also given the very green nature of the expenditure, about 30% of our bonds, which we will be issuing, will be so-called green bonds, and they'll be subject to a validated green bond standard specifically developed for this instrument. And I should also underline that there will be a very robust governance framework with very strict controls on risks and on accountability. So what we want to do with this funding machine is create transparency, predictability, flexibility, and of course, it needs to be done at very low cost, because that will benefit all of the member states. Now, I'm coming to the conclusion, but as I've said, these huge amounts of debt that we will be raising to finance the recovery instrument will actually transform the Union into a very active participant on the capital markets. And what we already see in our contacts with investors across the globe is that this will actually attract investors to come to European capital markets. It's very interesting to note that central banks across the globe and also other investors want to diversify away from dollar denominated assets. And this very safe AAA European asset is seen as incredibly attractive. So that will be a boon, a real advantage, because these investors will, on the back of our bonds, also look more widely at Europe as a capital market. Then I would say that it will actually also help create a maturity curve of pricing, which actually is going to be a reference point on the financial markets. Many banks say that they are looking for complementary reference points, which will help integrate the financial markets. And finally, all of these activities, of course, as I've already indicated, will strengthen the international role of the euro. I've not talked about the repayments of the debt, but let me just say that the Council and the European Parliament agreed that new own resources will be considered to repay the debt. New own resources, probably from emission trading or from a digital levy, or from a more harmonized a form of corporate taxation in Europe. So this new initiative will not just have huge effects on pulling the European economy out of the pandemic, but actually it will also transform European capital markets. It will transform the nature of the budget. And as I've said before, it should give a huge impulse to our economies. Let me close by quoting a report that was done today, or published today, I should say, by Standards & Poor's, confirming our previous assessments. We expect that structurally, so in the long term, these plans, based on our impact assessments and modelings, and very consistent with Standards & Poor's assessment, they should raise our GDP, increase the size of our economy by anywhere between 1.5% and 4%. So Europe will actually, if we implement this properly, emerge stronger from the crisis than it went into the crisis. And if we succeed that, then the very sad and dark memories of this pandemic period will be replaced by a very positive message of Europe pulling together and coming out of it stronger together. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Koopman, for this very, very interesting lecture, I think. I think you succeeded in combining two themes that, in fact, that we do not usually associate with each other, the pandemic and the EU budget. So, as you can see, we are not alone here, and I already saw that that this topic and the presentation raises quite a lot of questions from the audience. Yeah, so let's have a look at one of the first questions, which was about the relationship between from Peter Leroy. Perhaps you can unmute yourself, Peter, because you had the question about the relationship between this Recovery Resilience Pact and the Green Deal.
Yes, good evening to everybody. Thanks, Mr. Koopman, for a very informative lecture. My first question was about the link between the Recovery and Resilience Program on the one hand and the European Green Deal on the other. Of course, you mentioned the 37 climate rulings, but for another series of aspects, I'm a bit afraid, a bit suspicious that the Recovery and Resilience Program might in fact endorse business as usual and thereby frustrating the innovation that the European Green Deal is looking after. Thanks for your answer.
Marianne, do you want me to take this question or shall we take it next one? How would you like to run it?
I think, yeah, question by, we have, yeah, this is one question about the Green Deal. So, and then we go perhaps to another group of questions.
Do you want me, maybe I pick up on this one because it is a self-standing question, very important question.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much. In fact, I would encourage you, if you have the time, to look at the regulation that sets out the conditions for the Recovery and Resilience Facility. And you will see in annex to it, we have included very strict criteria when it comes to sustainability, bringing in a number of very innovative principles that have not yet been law turned into law more generally, such as the do no significant harm principle. So traditional investments that could do environmental harm are actually eligible, ineligible under this program. So there is not really a BAU possibility at all. And beyond that, the 37%, which is significant, will push member states to of course, go well beyond what they would otherwise be required to do. So the logic here really is that, if you will, we are accelerating the implementation of the Green Deal, because the Green Deal, if you will, is our long-term growth strategy, or to put it differently, the long-term growth strategy and the Green Deal will have to be consistent. Otherwise, there's neither going to be a Green Deal nor a growth strategy. And by putting this enormous amount of money available at this service, it supports the demand side of the economy and the recovery, but it also has these structural effects on the economic structure of the economy to direct it in the direction of greening. So this logic is actually in the regulation and is mandatory. So the Commission could not approve a plan if it fell short of these requirements.
Peter, I think that's an answer to your question.
Yeah, thanks very much. I leave the floor to other people. Thanks.
Yeah, we have also an interesting question about what is the impact of the huge supply of bonds on the money market? That's a question, I think, from Marijke Villain.
Yes, it's a very pertinent question, if I may. However, what is really interesting is that we have a conjuncture of two phenomena that at least for now, are not leading to upward pressures on interest rates. On the one hand, there is a structural phenomenon called the savings glut, which actually was one of the drags on growth for the past decade. So there's the excess amount of ex ante savings, which is difficult to absorb and which has driven down interest rates on a seminal basis. But secondly, of course, with the ECB being very active in the markets, and not just the ECB, but frankly, all central banks in the world, we see no upward pressure on interest rates at this juncture. So for now, we do not fear this. And in fact, what is rather interesting is that there's a huge increase in disposable savings in many economies, simply to some extent because of the pandemic. Households have not had the opportunity to spend as much as they wished. So household savings are at an all-time high, but also many companies have paused their investment programs given the uncertainty. So we are not yet there. This could materialize a little bit later, possibly.
Marijke, you want to add something?
Oh, thank you very much. I was just wondering, because we are talking about enormous amounts of money for Europe, but it's the same thing all over the world. So all over the world, there will be a demand for enormous lot of money on the capital market. So that was the reason of my question. Thank you.
We have also another question about the implications for non-Eurozone member states. A question from Ned Wiley. What about the financing implications for EU countries that are not in the Eurozone?
Yes, well, it's a good question again. Thank you very much. Yeah. I mean, there's two answers here, two elements of an answer. The first is that they benefit like any other country from the expenditure side of this program, because program is for all 27 member states. Where they stand to benefit less, of course, is from the effect of the financing on the euro and on the European capital markets, simply by virtue of the fact that they're outside of these markets. Now, of course, except for a few small member states, all member states eventually under the treaty, once they fulfill the conditions, should be joining the euro area. So this is a temporary disadvantage in relative terms on the financing side that eventually should be overcome.
Okay, Ned, you want to add something? Okay. Yeah, we have also a question about the implications or the consequences if countries do not ratify the Next Generation program.
Yes.
Well, that again, George rules.
Yeah. George rules. Two issues here. One is this own resources decision, which is really an authorization decision to be able to borrow. This has to be ratified by all 27 member states. And if only one member state, a state doesn't ratify, then we cannot go to the markets and borrow. We do not expect this to happen. the most that could happen in our assessment is that there would be delays. And the reason for this is that all member states have already agreed, and that ratification means that they have to go through their national parliaments or through their national constitutional procedures, which can sometimes be a little demanding, but we do not expect this to happen. Obviously, the second element here is if member states fail to submit a program, a national reform program, or their program is of poor quality and it is not accepted, then they will not benefit from the expenditure. Now, again, it's not very likely that this will happen, but equally, I cannot hide from you that if the programs are not sufficiently ambitious, then given the tight legal framework within which we work, we would not be able to fund it. So member states really have to make an effort. It is a huge amount of debt that we will be collectively shouldering for the next 38 years. So I think it is only fair that member states really have to make an effort now to grow the economy in a meaningful way. We will see in the next few weeks and months how good the plans are and what the collective judgment of these plans is.
Thank you. I still have another question from Charlotte Bien. Charlotte, perhaps you can unmute yourself, because yeah, it's quite a long question. Yes.
Which one it is actually you're referring to?
About the coordinated strategy.
Yes, so that was my last question. It's a more general question. So given the current context, I'm then referring to Brexit or less European-minded member states, or for example, Belgium, which has a difficult structure, federal regionalization, etc. Do you feel that the EU receives the correct mandate to set up and execute this coordinated strategy? That's one question. On the other hand, I am asking myself whether Europe is anticipating to this kind of behavior or mindset in implying such coordinated strategies, and how do you anticipate it?
Yes, I would say two things again. I think the first is that failing a European strategy, the health and the economic crisis would arguably become unmanageable. The health crisis, because everyone needs a vaccine and some countries would otherwise not get vaccines, or the health policies could really disrupt the functioning of the internal market, as we saw last year. So on that, I think whether you like it or not, and no one actually was anticipating this until March of last year, I think there is a wide recognition that it is inevitable. And it is surprising that in an area where we don't have competences, actually member states are asking us to do all sorts of things for which we don't have a legal basis, simply because it's needed. Secondly, I would say, on the economics, this is more challenging. But again, if Italy and Spain had not been supported, if we had not supported them through this coordinated strategy, I think the centrifugal powers and forces in the internal market would have become unmeasurable. Let us be honest. I think the Italian economy has not been growing in per capita terms for a decade. It was already significantly weakened after the economic and financial crisis of the early 2008s. Then it got hammered in a way that other countries didn't really get hammered by the COVID crisis. Without the coordinated policy, I think we would have been looking at a repeat of the sovereign debt crisis of 2008, but on a scale that would have been unmanageable. So I think this was actually recognized even by leaders who at the time back in 2008 were very skeptical. There was much less solidarity then than there is now. And I think the reason for this is that, you know, you can have an argument about whether you manage your public finances well or not. And that was the argument in 2008. But you can't blame anyone for the corona crisis. So because the source is outside of the control of member states, there is actually much more solidarity now than there was before. Will this help deal with all these hugely challenging trends you mentioned? I think it's very valid. I mean, it will depend on the success we need to deliver. I think ultimately, my conviction is that citizens don't really care about European competences and what have you. What they care about is that this bloody crisis is solved. They care about their livelihoods. They care about economic conditions in which they can thrive. They care about solving other big problems. And in that sense, it is a huge responsibility, because if we manage it, I think this could lead to a turnaround in the way a lot of people look at Europe. You already see this in the Eurobarometer polls. Europe is more popular than it's been in 15 years. It's very interesting. But equally, if we fail, the consequences will be terrible. So there's a lot to play for. Thank you.
Yes, perhaps, sorry. but is this then an agenda point? Yeah, in the Commission or the EU in general, to take this then as an opportunity, to use this actually to, I don't know, promote the EU. Is this an agenda point, or is it just currently just managing the crisis as it is?
No, it's not an agenda point. We're not in here to promote the EU or to demonstrate its value added. That is a consequence of what we're doing, but it's an important consequence because, having been involved in budgetary discussions since 2018, I think one of the problems we have in Europe is that a lot of people, for good or bad reasons, sometimes for populist reasons, don't see the value added of doing things together. No one realizes that the internal market generates about 10% of our economies, especially in countries like Belgium and the Netherlands. In my country, where there's always this endless discussion about paying 1% of GNI into the budget as a national contribution, people refuse to accept that in reality, this one euro they pay into the budget generates 10 euros of economic growth. So I think it is very important, this demonstration of European value added, but obviously this is not why we're in here. It's a consequence of what we're doing.
Thank you. I don't know how much time do we have, Annabelle, because I think we're running a little bit out of time. We have still quite a lot of questions.
Maybe still like three questions or something. There are more, yeah. Some that you can take together, right?
I think there's a question. There are some questions from Christine about the financing side. Perhaps Christine, you can also unmute yourself, because you had now you have the question about sustainable financing and perhaps about the criteria that, hello, Christine.
Yes, good evening.
Go ahead.
Organizing this presentation, very interesting. I had two questions from the financing side indeed. One question will be, how attractive will be these bonds with regard to the upcoming sustainable financing? So there is, I presume, a lot of interest on capital markets to go into sustainable financing. So this is one aspect I wanted to present to you. And then there is another aspect, and that's with regard to the financial or capital markets on itself. Which markets will be able or will be taken into account to engage in trading for these bonds? Are you having any ideas of this? Is this already regulated or organized? So thank you for sharing some insights on this. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, as I said before on the green question, we're developing a green bond standard that is the most ambitious green bond standard sovereigns actually use. So we've pushed this very far. We've tried already to anticipate the private sector standard that is called the EU Green Bond Standard, the taxonomy, for those of you who are involved in those debates, which we only made a proposal about and which still is not complete, but we've incorporated as many elements. So it's a very ambitious Green Bond Standard. And the reason for this is twofold. One, we have to practice what we preach. If we believe in the Green Deal, also the financing side of the budget has to reflect this. Mm-hmm. But secondly, there's huge demand for green bonds. So it's also financially attractive. What we see in the markets is that the premium, which is called the greenium in this field, is worth about 5 basis points, so 0.05% And that is a lot of money if you think about the interest rate concession in relation to this huge amount. So it also has those advantages. There's a lot of interest in these ESG issuances. Which markets will we be operating on? Well, we will be issuing under Luxembourg law. We're based in Luxembourg, but actually we are making our bonds available to investors across the whole world. And what I expect is that especially our bills program, so the short dated paper, this will be very attractive to investors in Asia, especially the central banks. And I've already had many discussions with them. They are very keen on this because central banks typically hold short dated bonds, which they need for liquidity operations. And for example, the Chinese central bank, for reasons you can understand, is not so happy that at the moment they're basically obliged to hold all of their international currencies, foreign exchange in dollars. And they would really like to have a more diversification, but there are no safe bonds. They want it safe, available at scale other than the German Bund. So we're filling a need in the international capital markets, which is really very, very helpful. Means that the euro will be more of a reference point internationally, but also that we can borrow at very advantageous terms. At the moment, I'm actually borrowing at a negative interest rate on average. So people are paying me to lend their money to, and that's a very nice place to be.
Thank you. We still have one more question. I don't know if that is possible. A question, Matthijs. Matthijs, perhaps you can unmute yourself about the whether funding is conditional on maintaining fundamental. Yes, Matthijs. Okay.
Thanks for the talk. Yeah, I wanted to ask if the funding is coupled to these fundamental values, these fundamental European values of equal rights for all, an independent judiciary, and independent journalism, for example, because we've seen growth of some authoritarianism in Hungary, Poland, for example, in the past years. Is there any requirements for these kind of things in the plan?
Yes, this is a question about the rule of law, really, and the conditions that may flow from it. The answer is yes, there are conditions, but they are not 100% coinciding with all rule of law issues. So under a new law that was agreed in December, any rule of law infringements that might negatively affect the financial interests of the union can be sanctioned by the union. And that is critical. So if your public prosecutor is not independent, or the judges who have to look after this are not independent, or your fraud busters cannot operate properly, then this can be sanctioned under this new instrument. What cannot be sanctioned is if you curtail the free press, you attack LGBTI rights, because there's no direct link with the budget. And the reason for this is that the general rule of law conditionality in the treaty, the European treaty, is governed by a process under Article 7 that foresees a different decision-making process. That has existed for a long time. It doesn't come with financial sanctions, and it's a very cumbersome process. The new instrument that links it to financial issues, so rule of law infringements that are pertinent to financial issues, that actually is new. And it's also in my department, and we're looking at this very seriously. And as you probably remember, in December of last year, a number of member states were extremely worried about this law entering into force. Nevertheless, at the same time, there were a large number of member states who were very keen on this law entering into force, so it has entered into force, and it will also apply to the recovery instrument. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Koopman. I think we took all the questions. Annabel, I'm looking at you now.
Yeah, we took most of the questions. Unfortunately, we don't want to have Mr. Koopman not going home tonight. So I think, unfortunately, we have to stop here. But I thanking you very, very much for this very high level discussion. I think all of you will agree. We had In the Naamsestraat, in the university hall, we had a few weeks ago, we had a discussion with the Belgian ambassador in Hungary. So that was a bit, you know, the last question refers to it. So the xenophobia or the less loyal policies of some of the European member countries. So there's still a lot to debate about, but I thank you. We thank you very much also, Marianne Maas, to lead the discussion. And I think we have to close here. That doesn't mean that the discussion is over. We will follow everything that the Commission publishes on this, and our specialists at the university will of course read this with a lot of interest. Thanks for being there, and thanks also all the participants for coming to the webinars tonight. I hope next year, or even earlier than next year, we will be able to do this on the campus here behind me. I see that the Dean of the Economics Faculty is also present. Jeroen, thanks for being here. And so the next activity that we have with the Brussels chapter is a lecture on architecture with the winning candidate, the laureate of the Brussels Prize. And we will keep you posted about when this will take place. Have a nice evening. There is still some sunshine outside, and we see you back.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye. Thanks for having me.
Thank you.